The following podcast is sponsored by High Beam Ministry.
God himself said, this is the way I want you to know me. God is forgiveness. When Moses asked for revelation of his name and his glory, and this is the revelation he gave him in Exodus 34, 6 and 7, the Lord God, this is God speaking, God describing his nature. Merciful and gracious, long-suffering, abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity, forgiving transgressions, forgiving sin. He said, Moses, you want to know my name? This is my name. This is how I describe myself, and here's how I want you to know and understand me. I'm merciful, but I am a forgiving God. That is my nature. Call me the God of pardons, the God of forgiveness of all iniquity, all transgression, all sin.
Doesn't matter where you start out. In the kingdom of God, it matters where you finish. It matters that you keep your eyes on the prize of the high calling of Christ Jesus.
Because we all make mistakes sometimes, and we all step across that line. But nothing sweeter than the day we find. Because we all make mistakes sometimes, and we've all stepped across that line. But nothing sweeter than the day we find.
Welcome to the Ersatz Coffee Shop. This is Jay, the Truth Barista, and I'm serving up a steaming cup of God's truth for the average Joe. You can catch us on our website at thetruthbarista.com, and we're going to talk about culture, current events, personal questions, quandaries, even faith in light of God's truth. Well, Larry, so good you could join us this morning.
Well, I am so sorry, Truth Barista, but, you know, on my way to work this morning, all of a sudden, I blew a tire. And I didn't know at first that something went wrong. All I saw was my instrumentation. There was a little indicator that was saying that there was something wrong with the front tire. And it was a good warning to me.
Okay.
So then I pulled over and, you know, knew something happened. But I could have driven, you know, for quite a long distance without really knowing what it really was.
And what would have happened then if it blew out? You would have been really serious.
Well, yes, and I could have gone off the road and had an accident, but that's why I am late. But I think it could be a good lesson for us as we're going to talk about atonement and the joy of forgiveness, because what are the indicators that come into our lives that help us to make ourselves think twice about an activity or behavior?
Knowing that you've confessed your inattentiveness to the meter, now I give you forgiveness for coming in late.
But,
Yeah, oh, you're welcome. It is actually really appropriate that we talk about that today, because I love the Psalms. They're so real. They're so gutsy. They're so authentic. They come from the heart. And David really is talking about something that is so common to all of us. It's Psalm 32. So let's go over to the Bible study booth here. Hey, don't forget your coffee.
Oh, I won't. Yes.
Okay.
Yes,
so come on over. Take a seat. Do you want me to read through it, or do you want to read through it?
I don't care. Why don't you read part of it, and I'll read part
of it. I'll take verses 1 through 2 while you're turning there.
Okay.
So the idea behind this psalm is that David is talking about how excited and happy and relieved he is, and how grateful he is because he received the Lord's forgiveness. Now, this is universal, because all of us on the world have this sense that we have done things wrong at times, and when you try to cover it up, it gets worse, but when you let it all out, it gets better. And this is what David has experienced, and he actually walks through this, and he's writing it down as a testimony to others to encourage them to walk the same path he did and to learn from him. So you ready? Mm-hmm. Verse 1 and 2. How joyful is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. And he says it a second time in verse 2. How joyful is the man, and I'll add woman, the Lord does not charge with sin, and in whose spirit is no deceit. So what he's setting up is this contrast between those who like to wallow in their sin and how miserable they are and how joyful it is when you're not and you let it all out and you turn yourself around and start walking straight.
Well, joyful means that you're being blessed. Now, this is the difference of translations, right?
Mm-hmm.
Mine, instead of saying how joyful, mine says how blessed.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, either one, it's still the same kind of concept that
right.
There's an attitude, there's a blessing or a joyfulness to being forgiven by God.
Right. Blessing is more of that, if you want to say more of a biblical, kind of a churchy word to a lot of people. They go, what blessed mean? You know, I've been blessed. Well, the idea behind it in this one is this idea of receiving something really good mm-hmm. from God. And what has he received? Joy. Why? Because he's received something good, forgiveness, he receives the joy that follows that. So let's talk about some of these biblical definitions. What is he talking about when he says transgression, sin? And let's put it in real words. Well, there's a variety of Hebrew words, and the ideas of sinning can be missing the mark or falling short or going too far, passing beyond. That's another one. I've gone past the mark. One is iniquity or perversion. I've twisted God's ways. Let's say I've twisted my ways compared to God. I've revolted and become revolting to God. I have rebelled against him. I fought him. And it's not some kind of an abstract floaty idea. It really means in my mind and in my words and in my actions, I have done something either by accident or deliberately that has offended God. That's what that means.
Well, you know, in today's culture, it seems wherever we turn, there's an ignoring of God, which mm-hmm. is really a rejection of him. So that's sin too, right?
Right. That's just an overall category, an action of what's going on, is rejecting God manifests itself in a sort of ways. Now, God created us in his image. He wants us to be like him. He said, you be holy just like me. So since his character is the standard of right being, and his will is the standard for acting right, so we should be right and act right. But a lot of times we do our thing our own way, and that's what creates this thing we called sin. So sin is our failure or refusal to be like God. He sets the standard. We fall short, or we deliberately violate it. Oh, you were going to say something?
Well, I was just going to say about sin. I think because most people don't want to talk about sin. In fact, sin is a word that we ignore as a culture.
Yeah.
We really don't want to talk about sin because sin implicates there's something that went wrong, and we never want to be wrong. We want to do away with that. Like a no-risk society that we
right.
were talking about before.
I'm going to make this a safe space society by completely ignoring sin, but that never solves that problem of violating God or offending him. You know, sin is that word that when we say it in churches and what people just look at that as a churchy word,
mm-hmm.
but it really is you sin against another person when you do them wrong.
Mm.
That's what it means. So we've done God wrong and we need to make it right. Well, you never make a right if you ignore what's right. And stop doing what's wrong, if that makes sense.
That makes sense.
Okay, and that's what David is experiencing here, because he's going, well, actually, there are four things that he's joyful about, and then we'll get into what he did that we think he did. All right, so four things he's joyful about. Look here. His transgression is forgiven, which means God has forgiven David his rebellion against him when David stepped over the line. He says he's joyful that his sin is covered. That means David's shortfall of God's holiness has been covered over. It's been erased. It's not that God's not holding it against him. His charges have been dropped. Now think about this. You've gotten a ticket, right? And by the way, I have a question. Have you ever gone to court for anything?
I have, yes, and been found guilty.
Okay. Boy, we got a lot to talk about here.
Well, it's confession time.
That's right. Well, okay, I don't want to know at this point. We'll talk later. But for me, I broke the law by speeding. But what's interesting is when the judge heard my story, I thought I was waiting for the hammer to drop, and I thought his hammer of justice, he looked at me and he says, okay, I'm going to let this go. And he dropped the charges. And by the way, that's the judge's prerogative. That's his choice.
Mm-hmm.
He can drop the charges or not. And so all of a sudden when he did that, wow, that feeling of relief is, wow, now I don't have to make that payment, or I don't have to go to jail, or I don't have to go to community service or whatever.
And it doesn't affect your insurance payment, right?
No,
your
it doesn't.
Payment.
It's great. So there's such a feeling of joy and release that comes through that. And that's what David is talking about. God has dropped the charges against him for his rebellion. And the fourth one is there's joy because there's no deceit. See, when we live in sin and we don't want to go to God to confess it, or we don't want to go to another person to say we were wrong, oftentimes we kind of hide it from other people. That's deceit.
Mm.
And the problem is that never helps the situation.
Well, when we talk about conscience, and that's something that God has put into every human being, that silence means that somehow that conscience has been sort of short-circuited or hot-wired.
Stifled,
or layer upon layer of deceit goes on ahead of it, so you can't hear that small voice saying,
See, that conscience, even for somebody who doesn't know God, that conscience is the remnant of God's moral standard in your life of what's right and wrong. So when we do stuff that's right, we feel good. When we do things that are wrong, oftentimes there's that poke. And sometimes it's really, really light if we have a seared conscience. Or sometimes it's real strong if we have a sensitive one. I like that seared conscience because every time I hear that word seared, I think of a steak. Okay. Mm. Now, when you look at raw meat, it's just juicy and it's ready to be grilled and it's very desirable. But sometimes when you sear a steak, it puts a hard coating of cooked meat across the top. So even if there's some juiciness on the inside, it's not making its way out. Well, that's a seared conscience. Things on the surface can get so hard, you don't get to that responsive, juicy layer underneath. And so sometimes you can even cook that top of that steak and burn it. And on the inside, it's juicy, but on the outside, it is charred. And that's some people's conscience. It doesn't respond. Even if you touch it, you go, this thing's a brick, you know?
Well, and I think that's where a lot of folk in our society are at. There's no conscience about what is right and what is wrong. They have no way of differentiating between what is right and what is wrong. And that's what a conscience does. It gives us a clear indication, this is right, this is not.
Mm-hmm. And this is what David talks about in verses 3 and 4. He said, when I kept silent, my bones became brittle from my growing all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy on me. My strength was dried as in the summer's heat. Selah. There's so much good stuff in here, but this is what stuck out to me, is when you sin, when you break God's law, when you offend God or do something wrong, it leads to guilt. It's a natural thing. What is guilt? Guilt is simply knowing we've done wrong, and it's triggered by our conscience. Conscience comes from a Latin word that means to thoroughly know. To know with God, God knows us, our conscience knows with God we did wrong.
So a conviction versus condemnation. Conviction then is what you're talking about. God's consciousness within us begins to allow us to say, there's something going on here that you need to pay attention to. That's different than condemning. What is condemning?
The way I've thought about this one is condemning is just like a wholesale judgment against you. So for example,
with no hope,
Satan condemns you. He says, this is wrong, and you deserve punishment for all of it, and there's no hope out of it. That's condemnation. You've come under judgment.
Yes.
And he's the one who's judging you. But conviction is when God puts his finger on a very specific area, and he says, this thing we need to talk about. And I love it when the Holy Spirit pulls me aside and says, you know, we need to talk.
Yes.
Because I know when he says that, the talk is going to end in a correction. Mm-hmm. And it may be a painful talk. It may be a good talk. But at least talking about it gets it out.
Mm-hmm.
What David is saying here is he's under conviction, but he's ignoring it. He's trying to hide it. He's trying, like we can fool God, right? And he's trying to hold it away from God. When we sin, our conscience alerts us and our guilt meter goes off. Now, another way of thinking about it in a picture is when we sin, the arrow on our guilt meter moves from innocent to guilty. Got it?
Got it.
At that point, that's when we begin to feel that something is wrong in the inside. Now, the problem is with modern psychology, they take the meter, and rather than dealing with the actual problem, they move the meter over and say, oh no, that's not wrong. See, it actually reads innocent. But then the person who is under God's conviction says, well, then why do I feel like something is wrong? Why are things falling apart in my life if you say I'm innocent? What God does is he takes that meter and he sets it back to where it is and says, no, you really are guilty. Now let's deal with the guilt meter. In fact, he kind of comes to you and says, hold on there, Bubba Louie. You can't do that no more. And he wants to move that arrow back over to the innocent side. You like that?
Well, Bubba Louie,
you know, know where that came from, right? That,
quick draw McGraw.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Okay, so what happens is, like in a nuclear power plant, if those arrows that are over in the warning zone aren't corrected, you're looking at a potential meltdown of a nuclear plant. How many people have heard psychologists and society say, no, no, you're entirely innocent. Don't worry about that behavior. Don't worry about that thought. Don't worry about those actions, whatever. But all of a sudden, over time, their lives melt down. Why? They haven't dealt with the guilt meter.
Well, that's what modern psychology is known for. You don't have to worry about any of those foibles or any of those morals. If you clean the slate, then you have nothing to worry about.
Exactly. And David is going through a meltdown here. Do you hear what he says? My bones became brittle. I was groaning. I felt your hand heavy on me. My strength is dried up as in the summer. He's feeling the meltdown from his guilt. And the problem is, guilt isn't all alone. Guilt goes out and has a party, right? And he invites his friend Fear with him. And fear is the fear of punishment. Any kid knows this, right? You remember your mom saying, wait till your father gets home. And I'm sure she had a low voice just like that, right?
Well, I was going to say, my mom was more like, wait till your father gets home.
Exactly. And the minute those words came out of her mouth, how did you feel?
Oh.
That dread.
Yes.
Right? Because, you know, my mom could spank me, but my dad could spank me.
Oh, yes.
And that's what David is experiencing. He's feeling this fear of punishment that's come along with the guilt. And this kind of impending doom is a terrible burden to bear.
Well, part of it is, and then what Satan does is he brings silence into the game, right?
Okay, now you got another one. When I was silent, that's important because we don't want to reveal to other people what we're going through. If we've done wrong, we try to hide it. It's just like Adam and Eve in the garden. You look at Genesis, they sinned. They took the fruit. They weren't supposed to. They flat out, they just disobeyed God. Did they run to God? No, they didn't. They ran away from God. And then what did they do? They found the nearest thing they could get, which is a bunch of fig leaves, and fig leaves are pretty, and they tried to cover themselves up. What are they doing? They're trying to hide behind a leaf. Now, to God, it's like, you know, you think little kids hide behind a pole, you know, like a flagpole on the playground. You can't see me.
Oh, yes, we can.
Oh, yes, we can.
Here's the thing, Truth Barista. I'm looking at a bunch of silent people in front of us right now. So perhaps what we should do is eliminate their silence by attending to their need, getting them the coffee and things. And why don't we come back in just a minute or so?
We'll pick it up at the silence. Pick it up at okay, sounds good.
All right, recruit, line up. What are you blubbering about?
Life is tough. The struggle is real, Sarge. How can I see my way to navigate life better? I go to highbeamministry.com. High Beam Ministry, as in car high beams. High Beam Ministry shines the light of God's truth on the road ahead, Sarge. The Truth Barista podcast covers all sorts of topics from the Bible's point of view, and they don't shy away from the really tough stuff. And while you're there, check out the totally awesome Frothy Thoughts blog. It's really neat. Tap the subscribe button and enter your email address, Sarge, so High Beam Ministry can let you know when new stuff is posted. Go to highbeamministry.com. All one word, highbeamministry.com, because the struggle is real.
You know what makes me sad?
You do! Maybe we should chug on over to Mamby Pamby Land, where maybe we can find some self-confidence for you, you jackwagon!
Go to highbeamministry.com. All one word, highbeamministry.com, because the struggle is real.
Everybody's happy.
Well, let's hope so.
Well, that's what happens when the caffeine kicks in. But, you know, that's what happens, too, when we break our silence. You know, we were talking about sin and holding it in, and David's holding it in, and the result of holding it in and being silent and deceptive, all that is really taking a number out on his body. I mean, how many people have carried secrets in their lives for so long? You can see it begin to affect their faces, or living lives of behaviors that don't line up with God. I mean, think of alcoholics. How is their alcoholism affected their face or their bodies outwardly. And smokers, same thing, abusing their bodies in a way that God says you shouldn't do that. And man, you can see the lines in their face, and you can see the effects of the nicotine and the tar coming out in the color of their skin. It's really kind of amazing. In fact, that's a lot like what sin does, because unconfessed sin and the guilt and the fear that it brings begins to alter us. Do you remember the movie Lord of the Rings?
I do. It's one of my favorites.
There's a real nerd alert here, because every time I watch that movie, think of Gollum. Gollum started out as a hobbit, and he looked normal, jovial, happy, and had a really pleasant life, and they find the ring. And what does the ring do? The ring belongs to its master, but he took it to himself. That's like the picture of sin. And what happens is the effect of the ring is to twist and bend the owner into an evil reflection of evil Sauron, the ring's creator. So what happens is when we have unconfessed sin, it twists us up on the inside, and it eventually works its way out. But we don't like to give that up. And oftentimes it's mine, my own, my precious. You like that?
Oh, I think you make a great golem. Really, really good.
Well, gee, I don't know. That's a compliment here.
Wow.
So anyway, this is what David is experiencing. He's keeping all this stuff inside, and he's feeling it begin to affect him. But the good news is there comes a point where we will eventually crash and burn and surrender. Hitting the point of surrender is important. Hopefully, we don't have to utterly crash and burn and see our lives explode. But when we get to that point of surrender, that's when things begin to change and start moving up. Okay, guilt can be agonizing, but God is also active through that conviction. He says, your hand was heavy on me. David saying that God has sent his suffering and misfortune to help me reach that real state of turning back to him. Because when you turn back to him, that's when the joy kicks in.
Well, the heavy hand is one that could possibly be his mercy, right? Because God's mercy does lead us to repentance, right?
Yep, that's what it says, 1 Corinthians 7:9, one of my favorite verses. Paul writes, yet now I am happy, not because you were made sorry, because he brought a convicting word against that church congregation there in Corinth, because they were putting up with some pretty rotten stuff. But because of that word, they wrote back evidently and were really sorry for what was going on. And he says, but because your sorrow led you to repentance, for you became sorrowful as God intended, and so were not harmed in any way by us. So basically, Paul says, I've forgiven you, God forgave you. And that sorrow of yours led to repentance. God drops the charges. He lifts you up, and now they're on their way back into a joyful state. This is verse 5 now.
Okay.
Okay, so go ahead and read verse 5, Psalm 32.
Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not conceal my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you took away the guilt of my sin, Selah.
Okay, now compare that with the previous verses. The previous verses, he hid the sin. In this verse, he just lays it all out before the Lord. What does the Lord do? Does the Lord crush him? No. God looks at it and says, okay, good. Now that we have that on the table, let me deal with it. And this is the thing that you learn when you read the Old Testament sacrifices, because it really makes it clear. On the Day of Atonement, which dealt with Israel's national sin, the sacrifices would be offered, and on that day, Israel's sin would be covered over by the animal sacrifice, and God would look at Israel and say, okay, in my eyes, you have a fresh start. And that's what David is saying. You've covered the iniquity of my sin. You've taken care of it through forgiveness. And because of that forgiveness, joy begins to set in. And with his spirit.
Isn't confession similar to a sign of humility? And in that humility, God says that I will draw close to those who are humble, but I will resist the proud. Because confession is really a humbling act, isn't it?
Right. The proud will not confess. Well, let me go back to this. What is confession? If conscience is to know with God, then confess is to admit with God. A proud person is never going to go to God and say, oh yeah, I did wrong here. Yeah, you're absolutely right, you know. But a humble person will look at God and say, I really did. I really did. A proud person would never go to their spouse and said, I spoke harshly to you. I should have never done that.
Yeah, forgive me.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Forgive me. A proud person would never say that. A humble person would. And you'd be surprised that how often, let's say, marital spats like that would be healed if a person humbles themselves and simply brings out and confesses, admits with the other another person, what I did was wrong. But see, this is what God wants. God wants us to admit with him what he already knows. It's not like he doesn't know it. He's just waiting for us to bring it to the surface and admit that, okay, God, yeah, you know, so do I now. What can we do about this? And David says, you took away the guilt of my sin. Now, here's what's important. This is the word forgive. Forgive means to completely give, in the sense that the person gives up the right to punish another.
You know, I just love that. You got to say that again.
Okay. Forgive means to give up the right to punish another. So let's say you offend me here at the Ersatz coffee shop, right? You sometimes, I would hold that against you. I would give you the silent treatment. That's a kind of a punishment. Mm-hmm. If I truly forgive you, I give up the right to give you the silent treatment.
I just love that. You lay down the right to punish. And I think that's what forgiveness, not only for ourselves, we lay down the right to condemn ourselves, but we also lay down the right to condemn others.
Exactly. And that's just an easy thing. But what if you've been abused as a kid? What if somebody has really harmed you? What if they've murdered a family member? These are some pretty serious things. To forgive somebody means I will surrender the right to punish the other person. Now, it doesn't mean the person who's broke the law goes unpunished. I won't take it into my own hands by holding it against them. I'll let the justice system deal with it. That way, we can really find forgiveness for the most terrible things that have ever happened in our lives and find healing. If we're walking in unforgiveness, it's like drinking poison, expecting the other person to die. But if we walk in forgiveness, it's like drinking medicine to heal those things that are wrong inside of us. When we come to God and he forgives us, now we're getting a double dose of the medication. We're getting his forgiveness by the charges and the punishment being dropped, and we're feeling the relief that now it's not hidden anymore. That's what David's finding the joy in.
And that's what, when we talk about the gospel, mm-hmm. we're talking about don't run away from God, run toward him.
Yes.
Because there's great healing and forgiveness in his message to you.
Yep, and that's what David says in verses 6 and 7. Therefore, in other words, because I've experienced all this, let everyone who is faithful pray to you at a time you may be found. When great floodwaters come, they won't reach him. You're my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble. You surround me with joyful shouts of deliverance. And there's some very good things here. Don't run from God. As you said, run to him. God's mercy isn't limited, but the time can be limited. We can run out the clock on our guilt. We don't want to do that. Keep a short list. Every day, go to the Lord and say, is there anything I need to clear up with you? So that's great. Now the Father gives David great counsel in 8 and 9. I'll instruct you and show you the way to go. With my eye on you, I'll give you counsel. Don't be like a horse or mule without understanding that you must be controlled with bit and bridle, or else it will come not near you. What he's saying is, don't be stubborn. When I start convicting you, when I work with you, respond right away, and you're going to clear things up quickly. And finally, David has a testimony in verse 10 and 11. Many pains come to the wicked. Why? Because they're unrepentant. But the one who trusts in the Lord will have faithful love surrounding him. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, you righteous ones. Shout for joy, all you upright in heart. David's taken a last look back, and he's going, don't be stupid. Don't be wicked. Lay it all out before the Lord, and he's going to forgive you because that's his nature. When you confess, he forgives. He drops the charges, drops the right to punish you, and you will experience the joy of forgiveness. And we find that first and foremost in Jesus. That was the reason why he came, was to provide the avenue to actually pay for the sins and the things that we commit that are against God, so that God can give us real forgiveness and we can experience real joy. That's what David is saying in Psalm 32.
Well, in Psalm 103, which happens to be one of my favorites, he says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget none of his benefits, who pardons all of your iniquities.
Yeah.
Not just part of them, not just those that are the darkest or the most sensuous, or all of them, even the little white lies sometimes we tell.
Mm-hmm. Yep, and that's what David found out. Now, David starts with the sin issue on there, but really, that's not where we stay. The point is we go to the forgiveness thing, that's where we find the joy. And that is such a great little psalm to learn by heart, because there are times when we do something and we really need to go back and refresh our minds. Yeah, the Lord is loving, he's merciful, and he's forgiving, but we have our part to play. We have to admit and come back to God. That's the thing that brings me joy.
Well, Truth Barista, you have been so helpful to think about the forgiveness aspect and the atonement aspect. But where do you really learn about atonement? I mean, unless you understand atonement from the Old Testament, the cross is a little bit hard to translate into.
That's what I like so much about the Old Testament, because in the Old Testament scriptures, the Hebrew scriptures, God paints pictures. And in the New Covenant scriptures, he reveals the meaning of the picture. In the Old Covenant, you had, as we said, the Day of Atonement, where an animal steps in to take the punishment for the person who sins or the nation that sins. There's another sheep called the scapegoat, and the priest puts his hand on the scapegoat. God says, I'm going to transfer all of Israel's sin and guilt onto that goat as a substitute, and then that goat goes out in the wilderness taking all of that with him to die. Think of that. Jesus is not only the sacrifice that gets rid of all the sin right there, the punishment for the sin, but then he is also the scapegoat who takes the sin away. Atonement in Hebrew means to cover over. Jesus did more than cover over. He erased. So every day is an atonement day, a covering over day, an erasing day of sin. Every single second is one of those seconds, those moments. So for a person that has a relationship with God, what he displayed in the Old Covenant scriptures, in the New Covenant scriptures, he says, this is the way it really is. Nobody ever has to suffer under the burden of sin and guilt. Ever. Ever. They can come to God and say, forgive me. And God looks at his son and says, done. And it's lifted.
And that's why the scripture says every morning his mercies are fresh and new. Starts fresh every day.
And by the way, I know some people are listening to us out in that other booth over there and over the podcast. You know, if this message has really touched your heart, or any of these messages have touched your heart, please let us know. We'd love to be able to share your story in another podcast. So you just need to go to your computer or whatever, your phone, and send us an email at thetruthbarista, all one word, thetruthbarista, B-A-R-I-S-T-A, at gmail.com. We'd love to hear from you and share your story.
Well, I'm going to give you a little bit of coffeehouse atonement. I'm going to step into your place in the kitchen and do all the dishes on your behalf.
You know something? I forgive you for coming in late. I am not going to exert that punishment. I'll do the dishes. You just sit here and you just keep with your reading.
God has everything under control. There's nothing happening today that he hasn't foreseen. No matter what may be happening in your life or the society in which we live, he's still in control. With God always in control, that means that he'll see you through whatever you're facing. Trust God and see what he does in your favor today. Thanks for listening.
This is Jay, your Truth Barista. Thanks for listening to the Truth Barista podcast. The best way to find out when a new podcast drops is through your favorite podcast stream. The Truth Barista podcast is streamed via 10, count them 10, different podcast streams. Amazon Podcasts, Apple iTunes Podcasts, Google Podcasts, iHeartRadio, Radio Public, the RSS feed, Simplecast, Spotify, Stitcher, and TuneIn Radio. You can go to our website, truthbarista.com, hover over the icons, and pick your favorite podcast stream. Thanks for listening.